So we're going to run through the scenario demonstration to help prepare you to be able to pass the actual scenario test. But first, let's set up the scenario situation. In this case, let's pretend. Okay, you're presented with a 56-year-old man who arrived in the emergency department complaining of moderate to severe chest pain and discomfort. They've also got some weakness and shortness of breath, and they've had it for the last 4 hours. Now, as of the last 1 to 2 hours, their pain is really intensified, and it's now radiating up into their neck and jaw and down their left arm. When you ask them to describe the discomfort on a scale from 1 to 10, the patient states the pain is currently a number 9, and they feel as though they're probably going to get sick and vomit. The patient care assistant is directed by the nurse to go get an emesis basin while the nurse keeps typing in the notes. And as you continue to ask the gentleman more questions, they stop responding and appear unconscious. The scene is safe, your personal protection is in place, now let's get started. Now, so this is when you would want someone to tap and shout and find out if the patient is now fully unresponsive. It's at this time they are unresponsive, so you want to call a code or ask for additional help, depending on your area of practice. The code is called in this situation, and the team is on their way. Now we want to assess for a carotid pulse as we begin gathering appropriate equipment that may already be in the room. As we check for a carotid pulse and breathing, we find no pulse and the patient is not breathing. It's at this time that we want to place a CPR board under the patient, or if they're on a hospital bed with a CPR button, activate it so that the bed will deflate and make the surface rigid if this hasn't already been done. Now it's at this time that CPR will be initiated. And as additional assistance or the code team arrives, we're able to direct each of the team members to their respective roles or assign them their roles if they're all equally trained. Now, as the team leader begins to take the leadership role, they direct the recorder to please record times, treatments, and any of the associated notes that are important to that protocol. Now, a compressor will be assigned along with a monitor defibrillator team member and a reminder to give CPR at 30 compressions, 2 to 2.4 inches deep, and at a rate between 100 and 120 compressions per minute is definitely important to be communicated. Remember, high quality CPR has risen to the top of importance even in advanced cardiac life support. Now, the airway person is also assigned and directions to prepare to ventilate are given. You know, one way that might be an example of how you might direct this, especially if a person is not used to doing it, is give them some specifics like, please prepare a basic airway adjunct and ventilate with 100% oxygen delivered via bag valve mask at 12 breaths per minute. Now's a good time to begin thinking about advanced airway if protecting the airway is important or if oxygenation with basic airway is not sufficient. Now, in order to obtain that 100% oxygenation, we need to turn the oxygen regulator to 15 liters per minute and allow the BVM reservoir to fill prior to ventilations being given. During CPR, the monitor defib team member is preparing the patient for rapid defibrillation. ECG monitor and defib pads are placed appropriately, and as soon as they're ready, the team leader should give the direction to pause CPR while we check the underlying dysrhythmia. It's at this time that the leader calls everyone to stand clear while analyzing the rhythm. We see that the patient is in V-Fib. CPR is continued while the automated biphasic defibrillator charges, or if the defibrillator is manual, the shock will be then given at 360 joules. Once fully charged, the monitor defib will call out, "Everyone clear?" Shocking on three. 1, 2, 3, and pushes the shock button. After checking the monitor, we see that the arrhythmia is still persistent V-fib, and it's at this time we'll continue giving CPR and now prepare to deliver medication. IV or IO are both acceptable, but at this time we're going to try an IV and only move to the IO if we're unable to obtain a patent IV for effective medication and fluid delivery. Okay, so we've got the patent IV of normal saline via 18 gauge in the left antecubital. At this time, the recorder states it's been about 2 minutes. The leader should switch between the CPR compressor and the monitor defibrillator so as to have a fresh compressor. This switch should occur every 2 minutes, or at least when you recognize insufficient compressions due to fatigue, if sooner than that 2 minutes. As the compressor calls out the last compressions, 28, 29, 30, that's when we switch. Two ventilations should be delivered and the monitor defibrillator switches spots with the compressor, readies their hands in the appropriate position on the chest, and begins effective compressions immediately after the last ventilation. It's at this time that our first drug should now be given. The team leader calls out a drug order for 1 milligram epinephrine, 1 to 10,000 IV push, and then flushed with 20 cc's of normal saline. The IV medication team member calls back the same order. 1 milligram epinephrine, 1 to 10,000, given IV push, flushed with 20 mLs of normal saline. That's correct, so now we can continue. CPR continues again for 2 more minutes, and at the end of that cycle, the team leader calls out, stop compressions. Leader checks the ECG and sees that the patient is still in ventricular fibrillation. It's at this time that the team leader calls out for another automated shock to be delivered, or if manual, another 360 joule shock. At the end of the CPR cycle, the defibrillator calls out, everyone stand clear. Shocking on three, 1, 2, 3. The team leader looks at the ECG after the shock is delivered to see that the patient is still in ventricular fibrillation. CPR is continued, and it's at this time that an advanced airway is considered in order to secure the airway, give synchronous compressions with rescue breaths, and be able to monitor capnography. The team leader requests an advanced airway using an endotracheal tube. It's measured, and a number 6 ET is used with a stylet. The endotracheal tube balloon is inflated after the tube is passed between the vocal cords, and lung sounds are auscultated between the left and the right lobes, and then we also check the stomach to see if we have any air sounds in the stomach. Now, if you don't have any stomach sounds and we have good breath sounds bilaterally, you know the ET tube is in the right spot, so we're good to go. Now, the recorder states we're at 4 minutes. The team leader calls out for everyone to stand clear so that the rhythm can be checked and announces that the compressors should switch positions again. The team leader states that the patient appears to still be in ventricular fibrillation, so let's go ahead and prepare for the third automated shock or the next 360 joule shock if manually delivered. Once again, the defibrillator tells the team and leader, shocking at 360 joules, everyone stand clear. Shocking on three, 1, 2, 3, monitor is checked after the shock and the patient ECG is still in V-Fib. The leader now says to continue CPR. The team leader will now direct the next medication to be given, IV push, which will be amiodarone at 300 milligrams. The assistant should repeat, I'll give 300 milligrams of amiodarone IV push followed by 20 cc's of normal saline. After they flush it and confirm the medication is given, the scenario continues until all treatment options are exhausted and all possible causes are ruled out. Now, it's important to remember that a second dose of amiodarone may be given for persistent V-fib at half the initial dose, which would be 150 milligrams after 2 minutes of CPR and another shock that does not convert the rhythm. In addition, epi may be given every 3 to 5 minutes and can be staggered between the shocks and the CPR.